I'm the professor of economics. My name is Elif Çepni. What is global governance? It must be, it must include cooperative leadership, and it must bring together national governments, public agencies, civil societies, and also to address global challenges. And also it must combine national and sectoral boundaries. It must be inclusive and dynamic. You shouldn't use hard power, should use soft power. And of course, it shouldn't be authoritarian. It must be democratic. To bring all these things together, I don't know, must be a difficult task. But the definition of the IMF, I think, includes lots of things in it, and we need to think about these things. So we all know that today's societies are very interconnected. That's why we use the systems view of life, holistic view. And we all know common problems of the world. And so let's name some of them: poverty, some diseases, wars, terrorism, racism, and depletion of natural resources, the proliferation of nuclear weapons, and lots of more problems, problems of business life brought with technological change, and how we can find common collective participatory solutions to them. That's why we are here talking about the quality of global governance. And again, there is another reality. I think no one can disagree with this. During last 5 to 10 years, some psychologists are rewarded Nobel Prize in economics because they proved through their experiments that we are not rational. One of them was Daniel Kahneman, the other one was Richard Taylor, misbehaving in our decision-making process. So we are not rational. Also, our leaders, policymakers, CEOs are not smarter and rational than us. So that's why perhaps we need to use collective intelligence. And governance and government, many people, they are confusing this. We all know that governance is a process. What governments are doing to their citizens and what international institutions are doing to us. So governance is different than government. Government, these are political institutions, but how we can govern these institutions and our citizens and global citizens must be on our table. So to create wealthier, happier, healthier future, how we need to design new ways of thinking and decision-making tools. But I will combine this with human welfare, don't worry. And how we can transform decision takers into decision makers is another important topic. And there are some questions that can be raised by all of us. These are a few. You can put more to this list. What have been the collective benefits generated by the evolution of global governance? And what are the most important lessons that have been learned from the process? And what opportunities have been generated by global systems? And what are the potential benefits of enhancing and accelerating its development? What conditions must be met for global governance to enhance human welfare? And why are regional and global governance regimes seen as detrimental to human welfare in some countries, triggering a nationalistic backlash? And what are the main obstacles to a global governance reform dedicated to human welfare? And there are some others as well, but as I told you, we can put more to this list. How the interdependence between peace, economic development, respect for the rule of law and human rights can be examined through a holistic view at global level more effectively, and how we can solve today's problems, because this is called shortism. We just concentrate on common problems, forgetting about 50 years ahead of us, and how we... By the way, one more point, what do we mean by human welfare? Again, there are different definitions, but World Bank, I think, is using an access to decent living standards. And what do we mean by this? Not only we should concentrate on economic indicators, what about happiness? Not only per capita income, but long and healthy life. How we can make people, we are earning more money, the per capita income is increasing, but we are getting less happy. We are not as happier as before. Loss of confidence, alienation, and lots of stress, we are dealing with these problems. So human welfare shouldn't be taken as a materialistic well-being. It includes lots of things in it, like human development index, social indicators, life expectancy at birth, the mortality rate of children below 5 years old, and literacy rate, and gender equality, and lots of things. And we all know this. I took this from the book of Capra and Luisi. I really value very much the systems view of life. And in our thinkings, we always mention this, a good summary of, then I will leave the floor to you and to Thomas. In our thinking, instead of self-assertive, we need to be integrative. Instead of only using rational thinking tools, we can use intuitive thinking tools. In order to make analysis, we may try to make a synthesis, and in order to use reductionist view, we can use holistic. And many of our relations are not linear. In our mathematical models, we use linear models instead of using nonlinear. So in our values, instead of compete with each other, we need to complete each other, cooperation. And quantity over quality must be the most important motto of, I think, international institutions. And instead of extension, we need conversation. And instead of domination, I think partnership could be a good value for us. I know it is almost impossible to... The problem is we all know all these things, but how we are going to force politicians, decision makers to take necessary steps, perhaps to appoint an international ombudsman, or I don't know how we can do this.